Busyworks Beats put up a video recently, and the things that he said in it were not totally correct, so I wanted to go over it. I don't want people to think that this is a hit piece on Busyworks Beats or I'm going after him. All of that beef is pretty much finished, and without further ado, let's get right into it.
Today, I'm going to break down the dark side of the music industry. If you don't know me, I'm Game from BusyWorksBeats.com. We train over 1 million producers around the world. Some of them going to work with Drake, Kanye West, Post Malone, Ariana Grande, French Montana, Young Thug, Polo G, Lil Baby, Trippie Redd, J. Cole, Kendrick, and a long list of other artists. So in this video, I'm going to break down the dark side of the music industry and show you what really goes on and why Spotify is becoming the leading voice and the future of Spotify. So let's hop straight into it. Looking at history, it tells us everything. Now, companies create narrative because they want you.
So this is one thing about this. I don't know where he got this because not everything on the timeline is correct. For the most part, the years are correct, but you'll see what I'm talking about in a minute.
To create a false projection of what the company is about to do. So I want you guys to look at history with me, and we're all going to come to a basic conclusion using simple history. So in 1999, Napster launched, and this was a piracy type platform for sharing music peer-to-peer. 2001, Napster was hit with a ton of lawsuits and they shut down. Now, the music industry at this point, they'll tell you, oh, we were losing billions of dollars. We were losing to the competition. It was billions of dollars. You want to know the absolute truth? Is they realized people were willing to share this music peer-to-peer, which meant direct-to-consumer, which meant independent artists, which meant now they saw all the demand for all the artists who weren't mainstream. So how did they take out their competition? They sued the competition.
There was a lot there. But the lawsuits did not occur because of independent artists or this fear that independent artists were going to take over the world. The lawsuits literally started because copyrighted music was being traded peer-to-peer through this facilitator called Napster for free. Nobody was paying for it. So if you actually want the timeline of events, I wrote it down, but all of my links are going to be in the description. But the way that this basically happened, I have everything here. The Recording Industry Association of America, or the RIAA, files a lawsuit in 2000 for copyright infringement. That was the first. Metallica, a few months later, sues Napster, alleging the service allowed the unauthorized distribution of their music, including a demo called I Disappear. Also in 2000, Dr. Dre joins the lawsuit. July 2000, U.S. District Court Judge Marilyn Hall Patel grants a preliminary injunction against Napster to cease the exchange of copyrighted music. The injunction stayed pending appeal. February 2001, the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals upholds the preliminary injunction, agreeing with the lower court that Napster should be held liable for copyright infringement. March 2001, Judge Patel orders Napster to stop the exchange of copyrighted material. Napster starts to comply by filtering content. July 2001, Napster shuts down because they couldn't actually filter the content. It was impossible. Too many people were uploading. September 2001, Napster settles with record labels for $26 million in damages, with $10 million additional upfront for future licensing fees, just in case they decided to run a legitimate service. In 2002, Napster filed for bankruptcy, and they were acquired by Roxio, and they were a legal subscription platform. That comes in handy later, because he's also wrong about his timeline of subscription services. This had nothing to do with independent artists. This was 100% record labels were not making money because who's going to go out and buy a CD when you can burn one and when you can get all of the music for free from Napster?
So that they can control it themselves. And who did the deal behind the scenes? Apple. Apple iTunes came in and said
Apple iTunes had absolutely nothing to do with it. So I don't know where he got this. I really don't. Because what actually happened was, first of all, Spotify was not the first subscription model. The order of which that all of this came about was eMusic came out in 1998 and they charged 99 cents per track. Rhapsody had a monthly fee in 2001 of $9.95 a month. MusicNet in 2001 had a monthly fee of $9.95 per month, but you could also purchase an individual track for $1.99. Press Play came out in 2001. They had a monthly fee of that. There was a lot of streaming services that charged monthly fees before Spotify existed. But if we're talking about streaming platforms that really, really made a splash, for sure, that's definitely Spotify. When it comes to the model that iTunes started, so iTunes did start in 2001, but they became a music store in 2003. And yeah, they were facilitating the sale of individual tracks for 99 cents. If you know anything about the company, Apple, they don't invent anything. They just kind of perfect and make things a little bit easier to use and a little bit more intuitive. But iTunes did not decide that songs were going to be a dollar. Apple was just going with what other services were charging for individual tracks. That's all that they were doing. They were not deciding songs cost at a dollar. That's ridiculous.
Every song is worth a dollar, and everybody just accepted it. Nobody questioned why the song was worth a dollar. Nobody said, why is this single, you know, a dollar or $4.99? Why is this album only $9.99? Why is there a limit to the price you can charge? It's because they wanted to control the competition. They wanted to take the competition out by the knees. Now, somebody beat this competition by Apple, and Spotify came in and said, you know what, Apple, here's...
So according to his timeline, in his history lesson, iTunes had no competition. Their competition got shut down, which would have been Napster, which was peer-to-peer and not even a legitimate service. Also, a little bit of the backstory on Napster. Roxio bought Napster. It, for the most part, stayed Napster. But then Napster became Rhapsody. There's a lot of stories there because Rhapsody acquired Napster. I'm sorry, because Napster acquired Rhapsody. So there's a lot behind the scenes that BusyWorks Beats doesn't seem to know about. Everything that he's saying here sounds just very, very conspiratorial against Apple. And I'm not going to sit here and say that Apple's done no wrong. But Apple also has a lot of things on the side going for them. For instance, they have computers, they have phones, they were working on a car, they're getting into virtual reality. There's a lot of side businesses. And if you look at Amazon Music, same thing. YouTube Music, same thing. Like, this is not their main gig. Spotify, they're more the ones walking around on stumps, because if this doesn't work, this is all they have. Spotify has no other products. Spotify depends on this music model. So, yeah.
Here's the problem that you guys have with iTunes. You don't have a membership model, meaning that every time I go to Apple, I have to buy a single album or a single song. And sometimes we don't have the cash for the month. So I'd rather pay a company $9.99 a month to get access to everything. Okay, so they created, you know, the rights deals behind the scenes to get access to create a membership site, basically, for what iTunes was already doing. So they got iTunes by the knees because now they could charge significantly less. Because now,
again, Spotify did not invent the monthly subscription to listen to music. Long before Spotify, also remember, there was Pandora, which was completely free, but they licensed all of the music that they would play. And they started as like, it's true, you could only stream from like a computer, but there were no ads or anything. But aside from Pandora, there were a multitude of other services that allowed the monthly subscription model. So it's not like Spotify looked at iTunes and said, hey, instead of iTunes, all of these companies are way ahead of like what the general public is looking at. They know exactly who the competition is, no matter how small. And they're looking at the exact business models of all these individual companies, and they're deciding what they're going to do. When Apple decided that iTunes was now going to be a music store, they based that on previous companies. And when Spotify decided that they were going to be a monthly subscription, they based that on previous companies that they were looking at. The way that Spotify set up their business at the time, iTunes wasn't even a threat because Apple Music didn't exist yet. iTunes wasn't going after the monthly subscription model. So saying that, like, but I'm sure they were already thinking about it. It just seems like he's really mixed up.
In order to get money out of Spotify, we take this pool of money, okay, from the memberships, and majority of it goes to the company to keep it alive. But the rest of the pennies go to the artist. And that's because they want to keep it to where they pay you 0.00000 something, because guess what their goal is? to keep you from competing with the majors because they know that.
Sorry. During Spotify's inception, when they first started, they didn't really have any independent artists on there. They weren't licensing independent artist music. They were going after the majors. They were working with major labels, and they were going for big names. They weren't after independent artists. And he later in the video does get into DAWs and how Spotify was flooded with music. But remember, these labels were paid a lot more. It wasn't 0.00000 something per stream back then. People would get more because there were less artists on Spotify during the inception because there were less artists overall. So Spotify was only dealing with the major artists and major labels. They weren't going after like Joey Dipshit down the street making music in his mother's basement on his Korg. They were going, that's not how you could start a platform. Not even these days. People need a reason to go listen to that music.
There's a huge demand for independent artists. They know there were tons of artists who weren't going to be pushed by the mainstream machine. And let me show you guys the back behind the scenes, what actually happened. So if you go all the way back to 2001, let's switch screens and let's look at the evolution of music production software. If you're not familiar, a DAW is a digital audio workstation. So for example, behind me, I have a Korg keyboard and we used to have to make beats on keyboards that cost $2,000. Now over time, they created software apps that we could load up straight into our computer. Most people just pirated the software apps and used them straight to make music. So in this world of invention we have, in 1996, FL was launched for the first time, Pro Tools 5.0 in 1999, and Ableton in 2001. Now this created the top three of all DAWs used in America. So there is Logic Pro as well, so I can't neglect that one. But there's also GarageBand released after in 2004. Now let's look at when iTunes was released. iTunes Store launch 2003. So we're gonna galvanize all these independents and all the artists around the world to sell their stuff for less than the majors. And we're gonna put them all in one bucket, right? A year later, GarageBand.
Again, Apple did not design the pricing model for a song or an album. They weren't the ones that started that. They were just going with what other companies were doing at the time. And as far as like Apple, again, I'm not sitting here defending Apple, but Apple was always a more creative system to use. So when it came to PCs, they were really, really good at Excel spreadsheets. Think Microsoft and Windows and everything that those things were designed to do. Later, gaming. Apple was always the more creative choice because it catered toward things like Adobe Photoshop, graphic design, and things like that. Choking to death. So it was only natural that they were gonna go after the music market. I mean, you just have to be business-minded. If you're already going after graphic designers and the more creative among us, why would you not try to incorporate a DAW in your, you know, playing field? And remember, technology couldn't handle them. They were analog. You know, once technology started to catch up and was able to handle the load that a DAW puts on a system, of course, yeah, Apple's going to jump on that and create GarageBand. It had nothing to do with Apple looking at Spotify. Apple doesn't give a shit about Spotify even today because Spotify isn't competition for Apple Music, because if Apple Music doesn't work out for Apple, it's Apple. Public safety alert. Sorry. I wanted to stop. Shut up. All right.
GarageBand comes out. Why? Because they want to give tools to the people that they just put in this little pool of stuff so that they can keep building into their ecosystem. It's the same reason when you guys at your Mac, for example, you have Mac developers and you have Windows developers. So Apple has so much power because they own the App Store. So you build apps for their app.
And Google has the Google Play Store. That's the way that it is. If you want to be on these platforms, you got to play by their rules. And developers need to develop these apps according to both software needs and, you know, the individual, yes, business needs of the company that they're developing the app for. That's not exclusive to Apple.
App Store, and they always have the control because you always have to be distributed through Apple. So what I'm creating the narrative for you guys is showing you the stuff behind the scenes was, okay, iTunes launched 2003. All the major dolls were set by 2001. And this democratized, I'll say, or made easy to access music production tools. So now we have millions of people making songs, not just a couple artists a year, millions. There's probably, for every one Nelly, there's probably 1,000 Nellies that are now popping up. Okay. And I just want you guys to understand this is the real narrative behind the scenes. They're trying to be ahead of the competition. It's like, how do you beat the competition who has complete autonomy, complete freedom, and complete independence? You beat them to the game. You beat them to the field. So their ultimate game, as you guys can probably see, is how do we beat the independent artists to the field, create the field for them, so that anything they grow out of this field, they owe us. And that.
I hate to tell you, Busy. The money's not in the independent artists, and these huge companies do not care about us at all. See, the thing is like, maybe if you take it like 20 years into the future, 50 years into the future, I don't know what the landscape is going to look like. But for now, if it's between Leah Jude or Taylor Swift, they're going to choose to cater to Taylor Swift every damn time. It doesn't matter that there's numbers, that there's more independent artists than there is major. That's not who the general public is listening to.
That's how they beat you as competition. They put you on their platform. Every time an artist goes to Spotify, you're their competition and you're being eaten by your competition. Every time you go to Apple Music, you're their competition, you're being eaten by the competition. Every time you go to any streaming website, I'm just using the top ones. That's the real history behind the music industry. Nobody's ever going to tell you this because they don't think of it like a CEO.
Nobody's going to tell you that because it's not true. His history is wrong. It's conspiratorial. And it's just not the way that any of it works. He's missing so many things, like the fact that there was no DistroKid. The way that you would even distribute to these streaming platforms was done differently back during the inception of Spotify. And independence, even though CD Baby, I think CD Baby or TuneCore, I have to look. So CD Baby was out in 1998 as a distributor in TuneCore in 2005. So they were around, but like independents were not distributing their music to these digital platforms because when these digital platforms started, people didn't like them. And for the most part, they loved them, but artists didn't. The major labels didn't like this model. They didn't like what they were paid on it, even though they were paid a lot more than they are now, because of just the complete infiltration of these independent artists onto these platforms. But the more people that came onto the platform, the smaller the pie got for everybody, and independents to this day are still getting the smallest piece of the pie. It's like, you know, 10% of the artists are getting 80% of the money. And that's still the way that this works. I don't see why he's thinking that Spotify is...
They think of it as an employee, and it's not a shade to anybody. It's the majority of people talking about Spotify, the music industry, the music business. They were all hired by one of these companies, Sony, Warner, or Universal.
Busy Works Beats is not thinking like a CEO here either. He's thinking of it as an employee has some conspiracy theories. I don't understand why he thinks that. You are not thinking like a CEO, Busy, when you say things like this, because your timeline is incorrect. And again, it's just all conspiracy theories. It's not based in any sort of reality. A CEO needs to know what's going on. He just can't confabulate situations in his head to fit his own narrative. But I think with Busy, he's assuming that his audience is not going to do the research on anything that he says. And I do read his comments. It's like, yes, King, yes, give us more secrets. And when you're dealing with an audience like that, it's true. It's very easy to manipulate them and it's very easy to make up stories. But is that really what you want to be doing with your audience? You know, or would you rather just tell them the truth? Because a lot of the times, the truth is more scandalous and provocative than these strange stories that you're making up in your head.
Universal. They're not going to understand what the CEO's thinking if they're a person that's hired. The CEO's not going to give them these secrets. But if you look at history, you can clearly see the game is
I don't know where you even get that information
to the field. That's the overall narrative. Because again, Napster was opening the realm and democratizing music distribution. So now independent artists were being seen for free, basically, and that's competing against the big artists.
They weren't democratizing music. They were stealing it. I mean, these major labels wanted to get paid. How are they going to get paid in a world where most people listen to CDs and now everybody's just trading this music for absolutely free? That's not a democracy. That's a dictatorship. Like, the people were stealing music. They were stealing copyrighted material. They were stealing others' intellectual property. And these major artists do not make an album cheap. Like, they have to pay so many people in order to put out these albums, and the albums were no longer generating any revenue because people were just burning CDs off of their illegally downloaded Napster music. That's not democratizing the industry.
So these major labels said, no, we got to take them out.
Yeah.
They partnered up with Apple, gave them the rights to put their music on the Apple store.
By the way, I checked absolutely far and wide all over the internet. Apple had nothing to do with Napster being shut down. Absolutely nothing. Napster finally claimed bankruptcy. Well, shut down in 2001, 2002. Apple didn't even come out with the Apple Store until 2003. This was not even on their radar. I'm sure they were watching it because they were probably considering a store, a music store, long before Napster was even an idea in somebody's mind, because Napster only lasted 2 years. So, and to think that Apple doesn't have the foresight just because they came out with a store a year or two after Napster shut down, to say that Apple wasn't already considering, do you know how, if we're thinking like a CEO, do you know how long R&D goes on before a platform drops a product, especially a huge product like that? How many different labels that they need to work with to be able to make the store full when it launches? Like, this stuff takes years. He's just not thinking like a CEO. I'm sorry, Busy, you're not thinking like a CEO here.
And they said, look, Apple, we need you to cut this company out of the knees. They took down Napster because it was too much independent competition to the big major labels. And they said, okay, let's galvanize everybody on this platform because we can own the field and we could tax everybody out of the system and therefore own the competition. Now, from there, Spotify came up with they found the flaw, which was the membership aspect to iTunes model. And they said, hey, I can get even more slaves for less. I can pay them 0.003 and we don't even have to pay them a dollar. Okay. And I'm making fun of it, not to say Spotify.
Again, Spotify wasn't the first to do that. And again, if we're thinking like a CEO, Apple was already planning on starting a subscription service probably before Spotify was even thought up. It's Apple. I mean, that's the same with Microsoft. The same with huge companies like IBM, Intel, Samsung. These companies put years and years and years and years and years into research and development before they drop a product. It may not feel like that, especially if the product that they drop is especially clunky at the beginning. But it's not like Apple is still not looking at Spotify as if it's competition, because Spotify is hanging on by a thread. They're yet to make a profit. Music streaming is all they have. They don't have any backup plan. Apple isn't worried, I promise.
Spotify's the enemy, but they came up with a better business model as far as memberships and spreading that consumer dollar, okay? And that's why they took the market. And you guys can see the rest about the IPOs and everything else. But what really accelerated all the artists top on these platforms was the pandemic, because, and I don't, you know the politics of the behind the scenes conspiracy behind the pandemic, but I will say that millions of artists lost their touring jobs, and not even artists, the support for the artists, the touring, the concerts, the live events around the world, thousands of jobs. I shouldn't say millions, but thousands of jobs were lost.
You were probably right in the first place. But honestly, when you think global, this was a global pandemic. How much staff even works for Ariana Grande or like any of these artists? Like, honestly, I think you worked to millions of people. Most definitely, probably lost their jobs. I think you were right there.
I heard directly from a tour manager for like an entire region and entire continents. They told us directly that there were lots and lots of jobs lost immediately. And that income had to go somewhere. So all that income and all that wealth went to these streaming platforms because people still needed to distribute their music. So they just poured into Spotify. They poured into Apple Music because they didn't have any other outlet to demonstrate live music. True. And that's why NFTs were so big at that time. So I want you guys to know the real history behind music, because it's not all flowers and it's not all good news. Sometimes the people that you're working for are your enemy. I just want you guys to think for yourselves. If you want me to continue this series about the dark side of the music industry, let me know in the comment below. Subscribe if you like this video.
Oh, I definitely do.
If you truly want to be independent, I just linked up with the company called Sampley.app. And I'm
busy. I would really suggest doing a little bit more research before putting out a video like this if you're going to continue to expose the music industry. And it's crazy that the MEC podcast and like these other like channels, they really hang on every word that Busy says. I'm sorry, it's not the ME, it's At Odds. But you really, really do, Busy's right. You do have to think for yourself and you do have to do your research. You have to look at who you're listening to. And, you know, again, I'm not throwing shade at Busy. It's perfectly healthy for friends to argue and to correct each other and to debate. By all means, you know, if anybody found anything wrong or if the article that I linked below is a little off, feel free, because the kind of person that I am is I would rather have the facts and deal with that tiny sting of a correction than to spill out a narrative to my audience that is incorrect. Thanks for watching, if you guys are still sitting here, and I hope you liked that new format. I kind of like doing it like this because it's gonna be a little easier to edit. Sorry that Busy's screen wasn't totally centered. I'm sure for some that probably drove you crazy. I'm gonna see in post if I can fix that. And as you can see, I got my first stage of monetization. So if you can hit that thanks button, oh my God, I would so appreciate it. Thank me for bringing you the facts. Again, check out all of my information down below. Do the research for yourself. And also, you know, check my sources. Make sure that they're legit. I'm not sure where Busy got his timeline from. It looked like something that he made on like Canva. And lumping iTunes that had nothing to do with the Napster shutdown and with that was pretty out there. But, you know, I'm not sure. Thank you guys for watching.